Mona Lisa Overdrive from The Matrix. These. So these and these. Little bit of story time. These are the original Bucart S400s, now considered the Mark 1s, because these are the Bucart S400 Mark 2s. And there's some different drivers in the Mark 2s, and there's a slightly larger box on the Mark 2s. And I had them up here to do A-B comparison. I was trying to do left and right. I know what happened. Chewbacca, where are you? She knows what happened too. I have the Bucart A500s, the self-powered, DSP-corrected, magical boxes of ear sex. Just sex. And you know who else has them? Maz Bucart. And he was probably listening to them, going, God, I love how these sound, these DSP-corrected magic boxes. And then he put on his faithful S400s. And this is what the original A500 is based off of. But, you know, they got a passive radiator on the back that's just a passive giant pancake radiator, by the way. This is huge. And he's listening to them and he goes, you know what? This isn't an A500. For obvious reasons that it's not an A500. And I think that put him on a quest to improve the S400, the passive one, to get as close to his preferred DSP tuning of the A500 as he can get. That was it. I think that's what it was. It's the only thing that makes sense to me. Because he didn't just, like, slightly change. He changed a lot of stuff. It's a lot of colors and textures, too. You could see there's ridge lines. And this is the older unit, the Mark 1. There's ridge lines on the driver. Now it's smooth. You could see the finish on the old one was, like, grayer, and now it's black. And then you could see that the this surround cone was blacker, and now it's gray, and a little bit rougher in texture. Actually, you can touch this; it's smooth, and this is a little bit more rough. The tweeter looks the same, and the back radiator looks the same. Feels like the same tension, same actually different plates. This one had black plates up here, and this is a silver plate. So a couple changes. The size obviously went bigger, and I guarantee you the crossover on the inside is a whole new ballgame. They also cost a little bit more money. They're about $2,100 for the Mark IIs. Mark Ones were selling for roughly $1,800 US. If you go to the website, you have to convert everything from euros, because these are made in Denmark, where all great speakers are made, and all great speaker makers are mad. So yeah, three different finish options. This black, which is now officially black and not like a gray, which this kind of startled me a bit, because when I finally brought them together, I was like, wow, this is like one continuous surface of the same color, and this actually has drivers standing out for it. We have black, you have white, and then you have the oak, which I have the A500s in oak sitting in the other corner of the thing. I did notice one other thing. And this wasn't told to me. I took the covers out. These are the covers for the drivers. Let me see if I can just do this. There's magnets. They stick right to the four points. That's why the four points is still there. You could do that, and you make them look like that, so you can't tell that the... Oh, by the way, this one is upside down, where the tweeter's on top. And this one is right side up, where the tweeter's on the bottom, which is the way the speaker's supposed to be, which is the way I wish the A500 was. The reasoning for that being... Shut up. No, the reasoning for that being... bringing the low end up. This is something that I'm theorizing. There's no Wikipedia entry for this, but I did that whole video on height dominance, and the higher something sounds, the more afraid of it you are. Like, you'd be afraid of a bear, then you're afraid of a 9-foot bear, and you're afraid of a 15-foot bear. Oh my God, scary big thing. Some of the reasons I have a home theater be tall. But I think by bringing the mid-range up and keeping the tweeter low, you bring sort of more of the visceral sound, the warmth, higher, because you can locate tweeting that a thing better than you can for mid-range. But I think in this scenario, I just like the way it sounds. Plus, I also have to remind you, and you can probably see it now, where there is an angle. The old one here is angled upside down and therefore angled down, and the new one is correct way up and therefore angled up. There was a slight kink to the box, which probably makes a hell of a fucking problem when they are dealing with this in manufacturing. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to remove the old ones from the top now that we've done our comparisons, and we'll get back to this in a second. I don't know where I ended up last time. There's an edit, and it's about a week and a half later. So, welcome back to the S400s. Slight change in the what we can do, baby tubers. These have made it real hard to continue the review. Plus, I picked that fucking background. What an idiot. For good and bad reasons. And anytime a sad song comes on, I'm just bawling like a little baby. So, we're going to switch it up from... That was Bear McCreary, Adama Falls, from Battlestar Galactica Season 3. I know, the saddest of sad songs. They play it all the time in movies. So, we're going to just shuffle. Okay, Force of the People, maybe something. Wait, give me a little bit more. Yeah, Tron. Okay. Like I was saying, I think, I haven't rewatched the first 5 minutes of this video with Chewbacca in it before. I just can't. But I'm going to continue where I think I left off. We were talking about things. We're talking about these once he's to be the A500s, but in passive form. And you have to pick your tuning with a speaker that's passive. There's a crossover that they've redesigned. And that determines where this and this meet. And it determines how it shapes the sound. So to try to... When you're doing a digital speaker like the A500, you literally just sit there with a laptop and go, this, play song. Oh, I don't like it. This, play song. That's a little better. Okay, this, play song. And you pick and you can tune perfectly and quickly, and the digital processor then puts it to analog, and then you get it out, and then it works. With a passive speaker, the problem is you are building a board that does that. So instead of doing type, 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 play, you're doing... breadboard stuff probably, and then you're swapping resistors and moving things around and then changing the values of stuff to try to get what you want out of a speaker. And I think what Maz has done is find a way to make this speaker as close to neutral, the neutral profile of the A500 as he can get. What lacks, although, is that incredible low end of the A500. Like, I don't think you can actually achieve the sort of low end that a DSP-corrected, self-powered active speaker can, because that speaker can literally go, what is this signal? 12 hertz? If this speaker's getting 12 hertz, it's like, all right, I'm just going to move this. And then it's got a passive radiator, so this isn't an active speaker. This is just sitting here reacting to the front speaker. So this front six is trying to do all this work. And when the low, low, low end has to show up, it's like, all right, I guess, maybe? And most crossovers won't even function to actually bring up that sort of low end. But a digital thing could literally measure and say, okay, this is below 30 hertz. That means I'm going to put on my amplifier. I'm going to exaggerate a little bit out of the front and a little bit out of the back, because the A500s have a back active speaker. So it can do so much more. That said... these are a pretty fucking good example, especially with a larger box than the original A500s. These are a pretty stellar example of decent low end from a just bookshelf, as Tron has indicated. Because I had a whole week of basically not filming reviews for morning purposes, I was just down here fucking around. And I'm like, you know what? I haven't used the DBX Go Rack in a while. And I kind of want to use those subs with these speakers, because I feel like what these speakers... Oh, I should probably, before I get on to the DBX Go Rack, because I don't think people are going to go back and rewatch my original review explaining this speaker. The kind of selling point for these speakers is that this giant fuck you waveguide that is on that little tiny little thumb-sized tweeter, this giant waveguide has a purpose. It isn't just to just shoot sound forward, it's to shape the sound as it comes out. And... when you have a 6.5 like this, you can take a measuring mic and you can go like this. Make sound. You only have to go really from the center off to one side since it's a circle, although you could measure in every direction because the box affects it. But basically, you can figure out the shape of the sound coming out, where it's the brightest, where it lulls, where it, like, over here, it's okay, it fades away. And what they did with this waveguide is make the tweeter follow the exact same as the 6.5. That was the same on the old set. So when you move in front of this speaker, where that sort of like peaks and sounds, you know, great over here, the tweeter does because of the waveguide. They've literally matched it. I'm sure speakers have done it before, but like this sort of speaker, like that tweeter is just being itself. It's shooting out in whatever pattern it wants, and the 6.5 is doing whatever it wants, and you got to sort of like find the middle point with your ears and just moving around. The Bucharts in general sound cohesive no matter where you're standing in front of them because of that design. So that brings something to a speaker that you don't usually get. Like especially on those like Q Acoustics. Those Q Acoustics did wonderful, big wide wash of like travel, like it brought something up, but you still wanted to be in front of that 6.5, so you had to like go down and then it would all blend. With the Bucharts, it doesn't matter where I'm standing. I stand here, I'm standing here, I'm gonna move over here. Don't do that very often, but you can sort of move around a little more freely. You have like a bigger sweet spot. It's just doing, you don't have to like super concern yourself with how it's angled because it has that feature. Now back to the DBX Go Rack. I loved this thing and I reviewed it years and years ago and I still have like two of them. And they went from like $40 to like $170 to like $400 to disappear from the internet. And it's just a box that takes XLR in and then outputs either XLR or you can get adapted for RCA. And it's a volume control, it's a preamp, and it's got this thing called subsynth, and it's got a compressor and an anti-feedback and an EQ, and it's got level controls, and it's very, very commercial, like you do for like a commercial install. But if what I have it doing here is I've got the DAC, the Topping D70S, which is RCA out directly to the Marantz monoblocks via World's Best Cables. And that's it. I got monoblock, speaker off a clean DAC, and I'm using the volume control on the DAC. Done. But I want to add the subwoofer. So since this DAC has two outputs, RCAs, which are being used for the monoblocks, and XLRs, which are being used for fucking nothing, I plug the XLRs into this, I plug the XLRs out into XLR adapters into RCA, put RCA into the subwoofers. So now this is an actual volume control. I think I had it at 48, was like my happy point. And I'll shut off subsynth, and we'll put it to 50. So now I can play that straight into monoblock, straight to the speakers, and then even though that's playing full range, I could blend in via that subwoofers. Could blend in subwoofers, or, and I literally would love to link you the DBX Go Rack, but you can't have one because they don't make them anymore. The subsynth, which for those people who are new to this channel, and by new I mean like within the last 3 years you've joined, the subsynth on that is fucking sweet because it takes the whole signal range, and where subwoofer stuff usually is, you know, 60 and below, subsynth takes 120 to 60. It takes a full octave above. I don't know what the octave measurements are. I'm not a musician. But it takes whatever information is there, copies it, slides it down, and pastes it over the 60 and below as well. So it basically doubles your low end. Like, things that would normally not be sub bass literally become sub bass. So now with it on, it's kind of like what the IFI Zen DAX and Zen cans and things do when you put on that X bass. I kind of feel like that's what's happening, but this is completely digital. This is a digital interface. It's literally got a digital volume control. These feel like analog, but it's definitely converting from analog to digital to deal with it and then putting it out, which doesn't really matter as far as, what's the word I'm thinking of? You know, when shit turns to shit, when it's not good. Oh, like high fidelity. Like, I wouldn't really want to put the DBX Go Rack through to speakers, because then it's converting from a beautiful DAC to back to digital again after analog, and then back to analog again from a relatively cheap unit. But with subwoofers, it doesn't fucking matter. You're not going to hear the fidelity change from that. So I'd rather have the full control of... That is very loud, by the way. Where's my remote? Vampire Weekend. All right, ignoring the DBX Go Rack and the fact that I've added subwoofers, we can mute that, but then it blinks like that, and it's very annoying. The Bucharts, are they the best passive speaker I've listened to? And I guess that comes with an asterisk, because, like, the Ohm Walshes are, I literally labeled them still some of the best speakers I've ever, I should probably not say some of the best speakers I've heard, or I could get out of a lot of trouble if I say some of the. Because then you like, this is some of the best speakers I've ever heard. And I can say that for fucking every speaker. Because the internet loves to hold you to it. Where's your tier list, Zeus? I won't make one. I'll never make a tier list. Because tier lists are stupid. Because if, why would you ever consider anything not above a B if I made a tier list? And here's the thing. There are some things that I'd give a C in a tier list that might suit you perfectly. For usability and affordability and the way it performs, it might be perfect for you. It would be your S tier. But I'd give it a C because it's not my S tier. So it's stupid. Everyone can make their own tier list for themselves. They can never make it for someone else. And if I make one, it's going to be for someone else. It's going to be everyone's going to look at it and go, oh, S tier, A tier. I won't do it. I won't put that. It won't lock you all into that fucking weird. I hate it. Be free, man. Carpe diem. Seize the day. Don't worry about what other people's S tier shit is. Worry about what your S-tier shit is. And you know what? Keep it to yourself. Unless you want to suggest, like, a movie or a music. Then you can, like, share it. But don't, like, write it down hard. That's dumb. So are these high on my imaginary tier list? I'm not saying. All I'm saying is they're a little bit more expensive than the originals. And I probably like them a little bit more than the originals. And the originals were, like, legitimately, they sat on my shelf going, oh, these are, like, if I need to show off what passive speakers can do, it was those. And now it's these. Because, I mean, I have, like, RF7s. Like, these are passive speakers. And I have Mica RB42s hiding down here. Look at them. Look at my original pair hiding. Those. Do we compare those to those? Those are $2,200, roughly, I think, if you translate to American dollars. And those are $150, if they're available. And then these are $3,000. What, $3,600 for these? And I got those for, like, $900. There's a bunch of, like, just pass the speakers that the Q Acoustics that pass muster so fucking hard. Then you got the smaller JBLs. I would walk over to my wall. Then I've got the Heresies in my home theater, which I've tuned perfectly now. Like, are those better speakers than the Bucharts? That's a 12 inch with two horns, and this is a 6 inch with one horn. But this is a passive radiator, and that's ported. Like, I really hate doing comparisons like that. It's not as easy to do a review where you're like, well, I want to know if this is better than this. You'd have to have such similar things that there's no, like, asterisks in line. I'd have to, I can compare the old speaker to the new one specifically because that is basically this speaker, just an older revision. This being a little bit more neutral, it doesn't take away much in the musical enjoyment. Those things were a little bit warmer, which, honest to God, and sometimes I just want it to be like a warm, gentle speaker, and these get a little bit more, hold on. These get a little bit more, I want to say the word accurate, but kind of like a slandery accurate. Like, they're so clean now that they remind me of a powered monitor, like a studio monitor, because he's reaching for that A500. The A500s, you can at least, you know, USB key and load. Well, I don't want it to sound like that. I want it to sound like this. I don't want it to sound like that. Sound like this. So your choice is to swap amps. I can go to the tube amp that took Sarita's devices and, you know, try to, like, warm it up a little bit. or you just live, honestly, living with a speaker, because people are like, well, Zios, why don't you EQ your speakers? There might come a time, I think I'm going to contact Mini DSP, because they sell that SHD unit. I forget what the actual model number is, but it has Dirac correction. And I wouldn't mind setting up like a permanent section here where every speaker I put on there, I just do 9-point room correction, and then I could turn it on and off to eliminate whatever is happening from the room around me, and then compare speakers that way. It's just, it's like when people get cars that are extremely high-end cars like Bugattis, and then they go and change the tires, the rims and tires. Are you doing that because you're an idiot, or because you know better than the Bugatti engineers? Like, don't touch it. These speakers sound perfect for what they are, and I don't want to touch any of the other back end to it. Although, here I go adding subwoofers to the damn thing. I'm probably rambling a little bit. I'm this is like my first review thing since the terrifyingly sad events of this Monday. So give me a break. But it's a very finessey, fine grain. That's you know what? That's probably the best way to describe this. It's like they've turned, like, you know, a pepper grinder, and you know you could adjust a pepper grinder, in case you don't know this. So you do it and you got big cracked pepper. You turn it, and you get a little finer pepper. Turn it again, you get even finer pepper. This is the finest of pepper. It's just like, it's like fucking powdered sugar. It's just every little... It literally adds refinement to speaker, to sound. Like, I've heard this song, it's Ruby OST. And it's just like, I've heard it, and it's like, but that piano, that little, just a little fucking piano. The only way a lot of speakers, like big horns, will amplify that, because it'll take that little thing and it'll shove it in here and it'll go whop. And it's kind of doing the same thing here. Is this the biggest horn you can get? Because this is a horn. I don't care about the soft dome. That's a horn. Is this the biggest horn you can get on a moderately sized bookshelf speaker? I'm pretty sure it is. Because that's a 6.5 on top. So it's doing the magic that horns do, where it can just... It doesn't have to work very hard. That tweeter just does its thing. And then it gets thrown into this massive waveguide. And it just delivers sound forward. And it does it in the shape of the 6.5. So everything sounds peachy keen. Peter Frampton. I don't know why I'm like sighing at Peter Frampton, but yeah, Peter Frampton, lines on my face, like everything just, I don't actually want to play these loud. I did, by the way, one of the reasons I had to stop the video after Chewbacca was walking around is because that tweeter developed a rattle and a hiss because I pushed it too hard. And these speakers are not like fragile. I've had the other, I did blow up one of the Bucar, but that was a traumatic event at my old apartment while drunk, while trying to watch Mad Max Fury Road at a bachelor party being held in my apartment. And I forgot to turn on the Mini DSP thing that stopped those from being full range. So my original Bucart S300s, the brown ones, the driver went, "You want me to do how many hertz and how many decibels? All right." And then that was the end of that. It literally ripped the spider off of the fucking driver. So I don't call Bucart speakers fragile. I just came down here, monoblock, a lot of power. Let's fucking rock it out. I want to hear the low end go. And I developed a goddamn... And Bucart was so fast when I was like, because just email their technical support. And I'm like, hey, this happened. And they're like, okay, that happens. Because one of the things that people don't know, yes, this is a $2,000 plus speaker. And the box is wonderfully crafted and the edges are just perfectly rounded and the paint is nice. The paint is now blacker than it used to be. And this cast iron, it's cast steel, cast iron, I think, or cast aluminum. I forget. I actually had to pull that off because the driver unit itself, I put in a drawer somewhere. The driver unit itself. Here's the thing about Bucart drivers. They're not that expensive. There's the tweeter for a $2,000 speaker. It's got plastic and then a decent magnet. And there's it. It says CDC 19 millimeter. It's a 19 millimeter tweeter. That's it. The drivers that Bucart uses are not crazy high-end drivers. So this probably costs $50. At most, $100. The problem... the benefit of that, there's no problem. The problem is when they want to replace it, nothing. Here, go, take it. The benefit of that is that you're paying for the crossover design. My water heater decided to give up the ghost. So now I'm trying to bathe with like 7 gallons of hot water. So my week's been fucking fantastic. Also, my insurance company decided I live in the wrong area and they're going to drop me, my health insurance. So it's all good. It's all good, baby. We're getting back into the groove of things. The shitty, shitty groove of things. The original drivers on like the S400 is like $60, six and a half, $60. So the fact that Bucart can take two relatively inexpensive drivers, throw this in front of that, and then throw this in here, and then build a crossover and a box, and then market it, and then make it sound like it, because it sounds like a $2,000 speaker. Like if you decided, oh, Zio said they're cheap drivers, like you could go buy these exact drivers and go build a box on your own. And then good luck developing the crossover. I mean, you could just take it apart and look at it. The crossover in this, I guarantee, is worth more than both the drivers combined. Because that's where the research and development is. That's what the time is spent on, the tuning of that, to get this to sound like it does. To extract what you've got from these. It's like putting cheap tires on a car, a small block Chevy V8 in a supercar. Everything else about that supercar, you can't do in your fucking garage. You can buy a small box Chevy V8. Doesn't mean you're going to make a Di Tommaso Pantera. Actually, no, that was a Ford 351 Cleveland. So if you ever look, that's one of my favorite cars of all time, and I've sat in one, and I could never own it because the pedal box is this wide and all the way over there, and you're like, what the fuck? But that's what this is. This is using relatively inexpensive drivers and tweaking the world around it to make it sound as good as it does. Let's get off of Peter Frampton for a second. I'm probably not going to be monetized for this video. I don't fucking care. I'm well beyond the point of caring. I just want to be able to talk through my camera. The cleaning ladies are actually upstairs, so I don't feel like I'm that alone right now. But usually when I was talking, there was always a cat around. She was somewhere listening to me ramble on and on about something. The only thing that I notice is that there is a perfect height, whereas the left and right doesn't really get affected because of the way that works with the throw. Because the boxes are slightly angled back and they're up on the doom stacks, which are like belly high, they're designed so I could stand in front of it. I don't want to have to sit in front of every speaker, especially when I'm doing a review. I want to walk around, I want to dance, I want to spin, I want to do all sorts of things. That's why the TV's up high. The TV's up high, the speaker's up high. But if I bring over a chair or the big gray ball, wherever the fuck that thing ended up, where's my balls? I can't find my balls. If I sit Slav squat style, this doesn't sound as good. I can hear it. It wants me to go up. Hey, go up. So you gotta sort of be, that's why they angle it probably. Because they expect it to go on lower, normal, like 2 foot stands, and you to be sitting, and they don't want it to aim here. They don't want to hit in your nipples, they want to hit right in your face. You get it right in your face, they're perfect. If you can see, the way I've determined it is if you can see the plane of the top of the speaker, like it just disappears, like if you put a dime on it, you could just see the thinness of a dime, you're at the perfect angle. And you could enjoy these speakers just forever and immensely. Hugo Sankey. One of my favorite shows of all time. It just has to be one of my favorite shows. In fact, let's put the subwoofers on. Unmute. Take it to 52 because I want to. And we'll put on track one of Hugo Sankey. You know, they sound like a speaker you'd show up at a show and be impressed by. Like, oh, damn. How much these cost? Only $2,000. Holy shit. And they put off, because they pull off enough low end on their own. You don't need the sub-synth DBX box and dual, what's it called? No, we threw a 14 again. Fuck. Almost every speaker needs a sub, by the way. Almost every speaker needs a sub. Just want to point that out. Like the RF7s, you maybe get away with it, but RF7s still won't do, you know, 18 hertz. Almost no speaker will do 18 hertz. In fact, when I eventually do get the Bukart towers, the self-powered Bukart towers, they will do 19 hertz, I think. Which is absolutely bizarre. Like, it's absurd. Like, it's non-compliant, because no passive speaker can do that. Because even though the amplifier might be delivering it, the crossovers in most of these drivers and speakers are just like, no. No, because you have to deal with it. It's very, I can't describe it because I don't know electrical engineering well enough. But to pull off the low end, like the low dead mouse all day low end, a dedicated subwoofer is going to be better. So even though I love these 2000s, I'm just always at a sub. Basically for music, unless you have very specific, lightweight, classical music, lots of violins, not a lot of fucking, what are those big drums with the dude from Spaceballs is banging on? As long as you don't have those all the time, I think you'd be fine with just these and no sub, but it don't hurt. Which version of this is this? Various artists, Tainted Love, we did our Love Go extended version from Soft Style. This is the actual version. I'm skipping forward. Hold on. Like, I'd love to play all the music, but I can't. I don't even know. That might even get this whole video blocked on YouTube. YouTube's a piece of crap sometimes. You know, I love these speakers. Give them a chance. They're expensive, but they're one of those speakers that you sort of work up to. That, you know, you could have the Micas, the RB42s, if they're available. They're $150, they're cheap. You get the Yamo S803s, they're like $170, they're cheap. Those are like the best of breed under a certain price point. Once you lift the cap off of how much you're willing to pay for a speaker, the only thing that I can tell you is, don't bankrupt yourself. People don't understand that why I got into making videos. First, I got into making videos because I thought everyone else was just sounded like a fucking liar. They were like reading off scripts and shit. I'm like, nah, that's not how I want to. It's not the review I want to watch. But I have to be daddy and be like, look, you're spending too much in this hobby. I'm the worst for this hobby, and the best for this hobby. I'm like, oh, I get people into audiophilia. But then I come down with a hard fucking limit of like, look, what do you make a year? Do you have kids? Does your dog sick and you need to take him to the vet? Because then you should just stick with the lower end stuff. Don't pursue this if you can't afford this. And most people who review audio shit seem to just be like, yeah, of course. You know, if you saved, if you just, you know, switch to this, sell your car, bro. You know, they could bury you in it. That whole speech from Judge Reinhold from that movie. No. These are a luxury item. These are something you work for several years and decide, all right, I want the last pair of speakers I'm going to buy for a decade. You buy these. You buy those. Those are actually relatively affordable. There are plenty of other speakers that I love that aren't as expensive as this. But this is, you get to say, I have Danish-made Bukart S400 Mark IIs. Just say, Danish-made Bukart S400 Mark IIs. That's eight words, and you get to say them every fucking time. And you're like, but, and then in my bathroom. So that's 11 words if you really want to be an impressive asshole. Yeah, I like these speakers a lot. I love Bukart. The A500s are still the best sounding bookshelf size speaker I've heard. Right next to the Swan M300 Mark IIs, which are sitting on that table there, which you can no longer purchase. So it's weird that an eclectic Danish speaker is more available than the speaker that's just made in China and they just had on Amazon. But yeah, there's a $4,500 to $900 difference in that. I'm looking forward to the towers. I feel like these are a good bridge. I know that they used to make the S200, which is the little tiny dual passive radiator, like near field speaker. And that didn't have as crazy a crossover. That didn't have as crazy a waveguide and a smaller 5 1/4 inch, but it had 3 5 1/4 inch. And I'd love for them to bring the Mark II of that or the 250. I think they said something about an S250 years ago, and it hasn't come to fruition yet. Because right now, they're very much like Vanatu. Vanatu's a one-trick pony with speakers. And Bucart has gone from passive to a different type of passive to powered to now going back to passive in a Mark II version to then coming out with towers. So they have a good progression. I want to know if Bucart's ever going to put out, and it's not cheap, the tower's like $7,000. But I would love to know if Bucart's ever going to go just hog-ass wild and make like one of those pairs of speakers that no one can afford. Because I'd love to hear it, because it would be tuned fantastically. Anyway, I'm done with this video. I know you're all sad. Thank you for the condolences for Chewbacca. It was a wonderful bunch of stories in the eulogy I posted. Zios, post a link to the eulogy for Boop Boop Bear in the pinned comment. My poor little baby girl, she's buried back there in a Polish tube amp box. Respect. Best cat ever. Sound demo for this in the description. Link to that wallpaper in the description. I had to film the sound demo still, so I actually don't have any more headphones to do, so I should probably just bring those mics over here and do that soon. Links to these. It's going to be in euros. I don't know why the site can't just switch to US dollars yet, because I know they ship to the US. Links to everything else I talked about. Patreon, subscribe, star, $5 a month. See reviews early. Participate in yard sales. I was going to consider putting the older ones in the yard sale, but then I realized I could build a little surround. I plan on bringing my Emotiva surround sound thing here, and I could then use the amps in the Pioneer, the vintage Pioneer, and I could set up just a Bucart surround sound, a little baby test surround sound with all Bucart speakers. It'd be fucking glorious. But yeah, yard sales, 1st to 10th of every month. Free shipping content to the United States, half shipping international. Getting access to the sound demo oasis, where all the sound demos go. If they disappear off the internet, they're always there. If you want to hear modern sound demos in lossless, you can get them there. And then there's a $10 chat that if you pay $10, you could ask me any questions you want. I really can't get, if you just, people keep posting in like the community part of Patreon, which I've never even like realized is there. Like, I know it's there, but I never check it. And I've been to other, I have like, I patronize a bunch of people, and I've never been to any of their community tabs. It's weird. There is a public Discord. There's a public Telegram. I'll kind of step in every now and then and look those over. But if you want to reach me, if you want to ask me questions, Zios, I need to buy this, and I want to, it's $10, behind the scenes Telegram chat. You also get, when you're in there, a lifetime swap meet channel. So if you ever want to sell something, you just put it in there with pictures, and then people can PM you directly, and then when you're done, you just delete the post, and you're good to go. And that's nice, because you stay in that for life, because it's too hard to police that, so it's fuck it. Thank you for stopping by. Don't forget to check out Hi-Fi Guides and the Hi-Fi Guides forums. I don't think there's any more Book Book Chewbacca things coming in the future. Unless, you know, we can clone a cat from a tooth or whiskers. I have both. Maybe I should invest my money in pet cloning. That'd be weird. I feel like you need the whole experience. The cat would have to be birthed in like a crowded house in the Bronx and then brought to my parents' place and then raised for 10 years. And then at the end of that 10 years, abused by the other cats that hate her. Chewbacca was a hated cat by other cats. No one liked her. They knew she was better than everyone. So she was one of the reasons I left my parents. When I had the opportunity to leave my parents' place and go down by Philly, my friend was like, I need a roommate. She was a huge deciding factor because I couldn't let her keep, she couldn't use the litter box. She kept getting, every time she wanted to use the litter box, cats would attack her. So she used to poop under my desk and I couldn't be upset about it because she wanted to feel safe in that little tiny apartment. So when I brought it to the old apartment, she brought me there. And then she got my Patreon. I was like, I'll review the cat at $1,500 a month. And my Patreon doubled in size instantly. As soon as I started saying that, it was like 2 months later, I had the money. And once I had that sort of money coming in, I was able to actually focus on the channel. She literally saved me. She saved me from living at home with my parents forever. And she gave me financial independence. And she's the best cat that ever was. Thank you for stopping by. See you in 2 days. Mm-hmm.